They are going to write and record the album that will be called We Can't Dance. It will take them 6 months, but they don't know that yet.
Back in the mid-70s or something, you know, I think Mike and I tended to dominate the writing very much, you know, that was how it was. And, you know, nowadays I'd say it's very much split between the three of us. And I think in a band I prefer that. It's much better if everyone's got a sort of equal thing. Everyone feels equally kind of responsible for the result and equally proud of the result.
How do you divide the production responsibilities between the band and Nick Davis?
Well, in a sense, you come to depend on the person who's behind the knobs, which in this case is obviously Nick.
And it's not...
It's kind of very difficult to work out the lines because you are all working towards the same thing.
This is the history of what became a hit song, No Son of Mine, starting from a noise called Elephant.
Please explain the reasons for working titles and give examples.
Working titles?
Is it me? Heads or tails?
Well, you go, you just answer.
I'll answer it. Working titles are really just a label you hang on a song so that when you talk about it next time, you remember what you're talking about.
It's really just the first thing that comes into your mind, which is going to be something you can remember it by.
This track, what's it called?
Elephant.
That sort of funny noise here at the beginning was a sort of sample I did of sort of noise in the rehearsal room, which was mainly Mike, but fiddling around with it, playing it backwards and sort of doing funny things to it. And it was really playing that, and as soon as I played that with the chord, we had a song, we knew that.
The melody on the first So Sad at the end there.
Yeah.
It's sort of a thing. It'd be nice if it didn't go down quite as far, I think. So you go so sad. It just went so sad. So sad. Just because it doesn't really go with the chord that's
so sad.
Just
so sad.
Yeah. Actually, do you want to hear Twiddly did on the old one? Because it's a really nice twiddle you used
all
to
right.
do.
Fine.
Maybe one. That's it, Gary, for a bit.
But Baccarat's one of my early heroes, really. And I love the way he uses chords and was able to have big hits with songs that used a multitude of chords. And I suppose the song Hold of My Heart, which we call okay. Bert, you know, has an element of that.
Provisionally named after the composer Burt Bacharach, Bert becomes Hold on My Heart.
Do you think that after 25 years, the danger is that you become too close to one another?
Well, I mean, that's the reason for doing all the stuff outside. You couldn't just do the group, you know, for this length of time. We'd have gone nuts, I think. But and you wouldn't get any new input, you know. But I mean, since we've all done quite a lot outside, each time you come back and make a new album, you're bringing new ideas in, and that seems to make it work.
Well, it's nothing to do with me.
It's nothing to do with me either.
It's nothing to do with me.
Yeah, but it's Tony's
video. During the 6 months Genesis are recording We Can't Dance, Tony Banks releases a single with Nick Kershaw, who recently wrote the hit song The One and Only. They meet again to make a promotional video.
I mean, yeah, that's just switched off, isn't it? You know?
So, Tony.
Oh, no.
When's the next Genesis?
That's a very good question. We'll hopefully get it out before Christmas.
What would you think if your children decided to get into this business?
I wouldn't really care one way or the other. I'd prefer if they didn't, in a way, just because it's a business I know, so it'd be more fun if they're doing something I didn't know. But I mean, it's up to them what they do, really. I don't think there's much likelihood of it, really. I don't think either of them are particularly sort of attracted to it. And my son is sort of old enough now to know. I think he's already, you know, perhaps it's because he's my son, but he's already a bit too cynical about it. You know, when I was his age, I liked everything. I had no discrimination at all, really. I liked everything in the top 30, whether it was Ackerbilk or, you know, Bobby Darin, whatever happened to be in the charts at the time. Whereas he's already as selective as I am, you know. He won't listen to most things in the charts.
Tony, what do you hate or like most about me?
About who?
Me!
Well, I'm not allowed to mention that song, am I? No.
The mic. He doesn't like me. What irritates you most about me?
Your height, your lack of hair. I don't know, actually, what can I say? I mean, you know, the guy's here.
So you talk about the guy.
I'd be totally truthful if he wasn't here. I'd tell you all sorts of things. all decided you've got to keep fit. I mean, I've been cycling forever. I mean, I've always cycled for years, you know. But to do it in the studio, I'd never thought about doing it during guitar solos, which in fact is a great thing to do because, you know, you can't stay in the studio while all that's happening. And Phil's decided he wants to sort of lose weight, you know, and stuff like that. So he was cycling around. I just cycle because I enjoy it, you know. In the studio, Tony's such a vegetable, really. There's no exercise at all. And so the cycling, it just sort of, you know, makes the blood go run a bit faster.
Do you compete?
Oh, there's no competition.
No?
I'll beat him hollow.
Very restful.
A restful-sounding song, originally called Nile, gets a Tony Banks lyric titled Fading Lights.
It kind of sounds like, you know, the boat going up the Nile and a slow-moving ship in the water, that kind of thing. In the writing process for us, so often we find things by mistakes. Someone hits the wrong note, and it sets you off in a direction that you hadn't even thought about going. When we're writing, Tony and I don't know what key the other person's playing in. And sometimes we come to record songs and I'll say to him, is that what you played? Because that didn't sound like that to me. You know, when you combine the two parts, it makes up a nice sound, but individually, they're often quite different. And vice versa, he'll say, you didn't play that, did you? You know, and it's just, he hadn't heard it that way until he isolated my part. And that's the kind of chemistry that I think is what is good about Genesis.
What do you think's your favourite lyric on this album?
The ones I wrote, undoubtedly, Fading Lights, which I wrote quite quickly, in fact. Nick calls it one of my terminal songs. I was sort of, I don't know, perhaps as you get older, really, you find yourself looking back sometimes and thinking about things that can't be anymore. And you don't quite know what's going to happen in the future, so you don't know quite what is the final thing. When you're actually experiencing the last time you ever do something, you don't know that it is the last time you ever do it, which is sort of an interesting thought, I thought. And so I kind of wrote a song about that. And sort of just generally looking back. It's a nostalgic sort of song. I mean, it, you know, it could be corny, but I think I was quite pleased with some of the lines in it.
Well,
it's
just surreal.
I don't think it would sound very good with the drums.
Fading Lights is about to undergo a drastic change.
The needle will be jumping off the record.
I often see solos a bit like sort of like stories and things like that. You know, when I'm doing something like the Fading Lights thing, the reason I wrote the lyric in the way that I did in the end was because I thought the idea of the solo being a sort of example of a kind of life, you know, ups, downs, and things going right and wrong away, is quite a nice way of doing it, you know. Because the way I write solos is they have a lot of variety in them, you know, they don't have to stay in one mood all the time, so you tend to get the different flavours coming in and out.
Fading Lights is nearly finished. Soon, the members of Genesis will be performing this music live on stage.
We're trying to do a song with all the wrong keyboards, you know, and stuff, and the sound is just completely wrong.
Tony, is it true you always had a fear of flying?
The first two or three times I flew in my life, I enjoyed it. And then the first time we ever flew as a band, we did a trip down to Rome, I think it was. And I found I was terrified, and I don't know why. I mean, there's nothing specific happened at all. It was a fairly gentle flight. You know, if I have enough to drink, I can be all right, just about. But I'm always conscious of it. It's the thing, if you stop concentrating, the plane will drop, you know. It's a classic problem, I'm told, you know. because you have to keep thinking about it all the time. And it's very, very tense after a sort of 24-hour flight, you know, and you're still thinking about it, trying to keep that plane in the air, but... It's true. You've got to think it. If you stop thinking about it, then it falls down. Sounds silly, doesn't it?
After all this time, Genesis still pay attention to reviews in the music press.
I'm always hoping that this will be the album, or, you know, what album you're working on will be the time when they say, no, hang on, let me think about this, you know. Maybe this isn't as bad as I keep writing or saying it is. But I think that time has long gone now. I don't think we'll get any more time or patience from music critics than we can expect.
Well, yes, but obviously music critics can change. I mean, music critics, they presumably can't be the same people there forever, you know. We have in the past had some people who used to like us, and there may be some who come back again.
Very mellow for Tony.
Mm. I'm feeling mellow now.
Mm, okay.
Fuck it,
we're all wankers as well.
I like Jesus He Knows Me, which is a much more cynical song, which is more cynical than Phil normally is. He's normally a bit more sort of genuine, you know? And I mean, I'm a bit of a cynic myself, as you probably spotted. And so I like this sort of very cynical approach of that song. I like it a lot. And it sounds good too. I mean, that's the other thing about lyrics, got to actually sound good when it's sung.
What have been the highs and lows of this album so far?
Heads.
Heads.
I think the high points actually were Blue Jeans and... I Can't Dance and Since I Lost You, because they started off from nothing and became something.
I Can't Dance.
I'll show you what's on it. How to construct a hit. Some money rolling in. Yeah, well, there's more noises. It's all out of keyboard. Just sort of percussion noises, really. And it's just Tony playing it like a keyboard rather than like a drum machine, which is quite interesting.
Blue Jeans, because it was like the riff had a sort of feel a little bit like the sort of songs they use in jeans commercials.
The hot sun stuff, yeah, the hot sun, all that kind of thing, that was improvised, and then...
Yes, and the idea then was to write a lyric that was sort of, you know, took the piss out of the ads for jeans.
Tony grooving on this Rhodes here, which sounds great.
Done in about half there.
And of course, the drums on it. Which
and the drums yeah. Were actually not me.
Keyboard drums.
I'd say the real drums at the end of the slightly shabby stuff at the front is actually him.
What stage are you at now with the record?
Putting the final thing together, assuming that we don't decide the order's not right. But I think we think it is right, so.